Welcome to CIO Leadership Live, Women in Technology. I'm Lee Rennick, Executive Director of CIO Communities for CIO.com. And I'm very honored to welcome Tina Mathis, Chief Technology Officer, General Bank of Canada. Thanks so much for joining us here today, Tina. Happy International Women's Day. Happy International Women's Month of March. It's amazing to have you here to talk today. Please introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your current role.
Absolutely. And thank you for having me. Yes, so I'm the Chief Technology Officer slash CIO, wear both hats, at the General Bank of Canada. We're a B2B bank, and we focus primarily on supporting our loans, retail loans and commercial loans. And we are rapidly growing, which is part of the reason why I am here. My focus is to modernize the bank, the technology stack of the bank, and I'm really excited to do that because we are looking at a future of supporting our fintech and neobank communities as well. So ready to rock and roll in that space.
It's a really large role that you have there. And, you know, I really appreciate you joining us. When we just got online, I said, you know, women often have to lean into all sorts of different activities. So I appreciate your time for this one and leading in for this interview. So it's International Women's Day, and this year's theme is Imagine a Gender Equal World. And I think when we're born as little girls and growing up, that's just part of our psyche and our consciousness of wondering what that would be like. And, you know, really looking at a world free of bias, stereotypes, discrimination, and a world that's diverse, equitable, and inclusive. So, you're an advocate for really building women in tech and women in careers in technology. You know, I'd really love to dig in with you just to find out what you believe employers, organizations, and leaders can do to really help build skills and build places for women in our space in technology.
Yeah, I think the reality starts with that we need more women to embrace technology roles or STEM roles in general. I've been an advocate for that for a very long time. I've been doing this for almost 30 years, and it's changing, but not changing fast enough. And so I think it starts even before the employer part. It starts at the university level, at the tertiary education level, is getting more women into STEM type of roles, more women into tech entrepreneurial roles as well. And that comes with creating an environment for it. So I would say that one of the biggest things that I've experienced in my career is, and it's changed a little bit, but pre-COVID as a single mom working in the tech space, there was no such thing as working from home and having that flexibility. And so you had to make some core career decisions about what came first. And your family obviously always comes first, your children come first. And as a mom or even as a single mom, that means taking a step back in your career at the time because there wasn't a facility or an environment for that to actually occur to that create that balance. It's changed a little bit since COVID, working from home. The hybrid model gives us more flexibility to do that. But I think that's one of the key things is as women in the tech space, it's a very demanding profession to be in. It's not a 9-to-5. And so having that flexibility is really, really important, and creating that environment is really, really important. I think the other thing is, it's a bit controversial, is I would like everybody to stop focusing on gender and start focusing on capability. And I think in my career, you know, I've tried to focus on what value I bring regardless of the gender I have, and making sure that value is recognized. I'm still not the majority in my industry or my profession, especially at this level. I definitely would like to see that change, but that, like I said, comes with giving women the opportunity to get promoted and bring that type of leadership to this executive level. And the only way that's going to happen is recognizing that we are different, that we do have different accountabilities and responsibilities as women and as mums, especially. So recognizing that and creating a system that supports that.
Yeah, I really love that feedback. I support HackerGal. It's an organization, a charitable organization that helps in young girls, I think grades 5 to 9, and in high school as well, to learn about STEM and STEAM and do a hackathon. And you know, there's a lot of research around the fact that girls get to a certain age, they're interested in science or STEM, and then there's a stigma around it, and they back away from it. So I think, you know, your position of just making sure we're supporting organizations and people that are moving girls through the system to understand it's a welcoming place, you know, is so important. You know, what I find is, you know, in talking to individuals, is that women may often have the same skills as a man in the same role, but the man may be a director and the woman may be a manager, right? Because, like you said, we have to speak up and show our value and our worth. We have to understand that. So I think, you know, that's a lot of work that I'm looking at now, is how to, you know, when removing that bias. Everyone has bias around something, so trying to remove it. And I think for our male allies who are in those leadership roles, maybe digging just a little bit deeper to understand somebody's capabilities, as you said, so that more women can then become in that space, in the leadership roles, that probably do have a lot of the same skills that, you know, the man at a higher level may have built up. So that's a lot of the research I'm looking at, some of the strategies I'm looking at. And yeah, I find that interesting.
I think also, Lee, is that I'm not an engineer. I'm a CTO and I'm not a computer science major. You know, there
Right.
are other avenues that
Right.
get you to this point.
Yeah.
And so I think it's also encouraging that, like, if you're a business grad, or you know, you're even in the arts, if this is a passion of yours, advocate for it. And I think we also, as an industry, need to look at that as well. There are a lot of creatives in the tech world.
Right, we talked about that. And this really segues well into the next question, which is around elevating tech to the strategic table. So, you know, when we'd last chatted, we talked about technology and how now it's being elevated to the strategic table. In fact, we put out a report, the State of the CIO 2024 report, and 79% of CIOs surveyed said that they felt their role was now, as an educational learning teaching partner of the CEO and the board of directors. So, you know, really being at that strategic table. And we know that in the past, you know, tech has often been seen as a cost center rather than it being a place where innovation and business grow together. So could you talk a little bit about that and your thoughts around that?
Yeah, I think a lot of it has to do with the type of industry you're in. I've primarily worked in oil and gas, government, and education and finance. And those are very traditional organizations where technology was seen as a commodity, so to speak, a cost center. I think that's changing slightly in those industries, especially with modernization and the rapid change in technology and the use of it by the average person. But I think what people fail to see is two things. One is that it's a profession. So we're not just the people that fix your laptop. You know, we actually have a line of sight into what goes on in the organization in general. We see the guts of it, all the business processes, all the decisions that are made, all touch technology in some shape, way, or form. And you ask any CIO or any IT operator, and they'll be able to tell you everything about that organization and that business. And so I think we are definitely a very valuable resource to have at that strategic table. And I think we should be taken more advantage of, to be honest, and we're not. And I think that comes at a cost to an organization today, especially as we change rapidly. The second thing, I think we've done ourselves a bit of a disservice in that our job is to, as a CIO, is to operate and protect. As a CTO, it's to enable and build. And the CTO role is actually not, it's quite a recent role, I would say, in the last decade. And so there's still that stigma, I guess, that bias that we're the no people, not the yes people, right? And so that's why I think a lot of times we're not invited to that table, is because we have to say no. I like to say we have to say yes, and when we're protecting the bank, in our case, or protecting an organization, but in the build type of scenario, we're the ones that are coming up with the ideas on how to enable some of the business processes or business ideas that come up. And so that's why I think we've done ourselves a disservice in that we've built that sort of brand image around who we are, and that's something we have to change.
Yeah, and I mean, I find it interesting. Some of the CIOs I speak with really talk about that aspect of, now being many companies being tech companies. I think you and I've chatted about that. People are saying now, well, we're not a bank, we're a tech company, which in a way is kind of true because, you're delivering a lot of services to your clients mainly through technology, right? So I think that's been a bit of a pivot, but we still see, we do see a bit of resistance at that board and CEO level again of looking at it as a cost center, right? I think that it is evolving and starting to evolve pretty dramatically. But it'll be interesting to see now what happens around, Gen AI and large language models. So I wanted to ask you about that. We chatted about the organizational readiness for Gen AI and large language models, but how often there's risk and compliance, and you have to really be careful on how you're driving your decision making. And that often, if these types of new technologies are driven by decision making rather than innovation first. So, could you talk a little bit about that?
The organizational impact, I think, is probably a better word than readiness for AI, for Gen AI and large language models. And the reason why I say that is, I've been working in the AI space now for about 7 years. I know it's sort of front and center, but it's been around a while. And we kind of knew what the impact was going to be, but I think the bigger thing is the cultural impact it's going to have. And if you're a CIO and you a CTO and you haven't embraced Gen AI yet, I think that it's really important that you think about it and work with your business partners in terms of what the cultural impact is going to be. I kind of liken it to when Macs became a thing in the corporate world, right? And iPhones, we resisted it, resisted it. We wanted everybody to be on a BlackBerry. There's no way this is going to happen. We were all Microsoft shops. It's with, and the consumer pushed it into the corporate world, and we had to deal with it. Well, generative AI is the same. If you think about Copilot and how it's available to consumer population right now, people in your organizations are using it. Right. So you have to think about already. And if you haven't got policy around it, there's inherent risk in that already. But they're already using it, so embrace it, figure out a way to bring it on. The cultural impact it's going to have is that some of the things that we see is, we'll get proposals, or we'll get statements that you can tell have been written by some type of generative AI, right? And so you're starting to lose some of that subject matter expertise because over time, we're going to become lazier and lazier and rely too much on that. And we're going to lose that subject matter expertise. But also, the cultural impact that I'm talking about is around authenticity and trust. So when you're receiving something like this from a colleague or from a team member, and you know that they haven't written it, you start to lose trust in that person's expertise or in that person's opinion. So it's a little bit of a balance. I don't think people are looking at it from that cultural impact perspective in the organization. Will it be, hugely important in terms of enabling each employee to do their jobs a little bit easier, a little bit more effectively? Absolutely. Does it bring that virtual assistant or virtual advisor to your role? Absolutely, it does. Will it have an impact on culture? Yes, it will. And you get to determine whether that's going to be a positive or a negative one. In terms of risk, I think risk is something I learned, earlier on in my career, especially when as I delved into innovation, is that risk is something to be managed, but shouldn't actually lead anything, right? And so I think you need to be able to apply risk as a treatment or a layer or a lens to what you're doing. But if you lead with risk, you'll hinder things like innovation. And what I mean by that is you got to allow people to fail, right? And failing is actually managing risk. So if you get people, if you experiment early, if you're experimenting with large language models, if you're experimenting, you know, with generative AI, you know, bring your risk partner along. But I would say understand what the boundaries are from your risk partner. Don't let that lead what you're doing. And fail as early as possible. Learn from it. Manage the risk along the way. It's a method, a framework that you learn if you follow any type of lean startup methodologies. And it's a way to manage risk along the way. So that's what I would say.
Yeah. Well, thank you for sharing that. And you said something that was really important to me, because one of the reasons why I do these series and these interviews is to create trust and authenticity, you know, to make sure that, you know, we still have voices of individuals such as yourself who are leading organizations to create, you know, good outcomes for their customers and clients. And so it's really important to talk to individuals like yourself. And I really appreciate you joining me here today. Thank you so much, Tina. Happy International Women's Day. Again, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me. And by the way, I was actually got my offer letter for this job on International Women's Day. So it means a lot to me.
Yeah. Oh my God, that's fantastic. Congratulations. Thank you again. And if you're interested in watching this video or others, please head on over to cio.com/CA. Thanks again.